Hey everyone, welcome back to my channel. I was finally able to get everybody together for that panel I promised you months ago. Training can get a little bit busy and everyone's lives, you know, takes a little while to get everyone together. But I'm happy to give you the 6 questions that we mostly got asked and some bonus reels and a wrap session at the end of this. So if you have any more questions or comments that you want to give to us or ask us to answer, we're going to leave our contact information right there in the description box and let us know. So welcome back. I know it's been 5 months, but we're here to give you guys the answers to the questions that you asked, and then some. All right, let's get started. Hi, well, I'm SJ, still a student, SISO.
I'm Nia, I am an EWO on AC130.
Bria, I am a SISO on the U28.
Zarina, Wizzo, F15, Shark Eagle.
And I'm Mallory, and I'm an EWO on MC130H Talent 2. And we have our list of questions everyone answered, and we have multiple backgrounds here. We have Academy, we have ROTC, and Prior E, and we have
OTS,
all three of us. Alright.
So for ROTC, 2.5 is the requirement. Different schools, different detachments, I should say, sometimes have their own standard, which would be a little bit higher than that 2.5, but 2.5 is the basic standard.
And OTS was?
I think when we went in, it was across the board 3.2, mm-hmm. But now they've changed it to where rated is 2.5 and non-rated is 3.0. Why there's a difference,
we're not sure. We're discussing that. All right. Well, I'll go first. My interview process was a little informal. We went in, and I met with a major, and we sat down, kind of. What they do in an interview, they try to get the full person concept, so sometimes it can be formal, sometimes it can be informal, but they kind of ask you about your resume and what the stuff that you brought in for your packet, so they can talk to you about anything about your last job or, you know, your hobbies or anything. So I got questions about tap dancing and lifeguarding, and other people got questions about fishing and other things. Anybody else?
For me, I got asked questions about my resume background, places that I've worked. And then also, since I came from a military family, my father is getting out of the Army, I moved a lot, so that was another thing that we talked about and had some commonalities there.
Yeah, same for me, the resume, and then definitely a focus on leadership abilities and qualities.
Do you guys have interview processes?
Yes.
Hey,
okay, so it's a very long process. If you want to get into the nitty gritty, I suggest going to the website for the Academy, the Air Force Academy specifically. But first you talk to a recruiter, and the recruiter, he'll ask you a question about, you know, why you want to join the Air Force Academy, the military in general, if your family has any relationship, what you did in school, what you plan on doing if you do get into the Academy, basic, you know, why should we accept you type things. And then he gauges how you are able to present yourself to other people, and how you were able to articulate your words. After you do that, then you continue going through a process where you get a nomination either from the president, a congressman, or a senator. Each state has set numbers of people that set numbers of applicants that they can push forward. I got one from my congressman, and he wasn't present, but at the board they asked me, you know, why they should pick me over the other two people who were there, and lucky me, I was the only female, so that was a pretty good go-to right there. But as a whole, like, they expected a letter or a paper explaining, you know, why should we pick you type things and stuff like that. And then after that, you have good SAT scores, and they put that in a giant giant packet to ship up to the school, and they sort you out.
Was there any for ROTC when you were going through?
Well, my entry into ROTC was pretty non-standard. My story is kind of different from everyone else that I know that has been through. But for the most part, if you're interested in it, you talk to one of the cadre members there. You fill out paperwork. You provide like transcripts and SAT scores and all that good stuff. And then they'll enroll you in some of the general military courses with, it's like basic Air Force history and stuff like that. And then you pretty much kind of like work your way through the program. And you have to keep up with PT and your other academic courses. So you kind of either weed yourself out or you make it through at that point once you get through the initial interview process. All right.
Sure, volunteer experience. I have a lot, but more like the most recent stuff I had right before I applied to OTS was doing reading partners. And I did that as soon as I got back into the States and was going through the whole application process, which for me, with applying right after sequestration took a long time, so I did that for a while right before. But other than that, I mean, all my volunteer experience has been education focused. And right now I'm mostly focused on my career path, so I'm not doing anything in particular right now, but I definitely put down my past education volunteer experience on my
experience. I guess I'll start post high school. So when I was in college, I did Habitat for Humanity, and then I just worked. So really that's all the experience that I got heavily into Habitat, and then I worked a lot on the side while I was in school.
I also worked a lot. I had like two or three jobs at one time at school, but most of the time I did at least one service activity a week. A lot of stuff was with my sorority, and I'm just overall involved. Honors College and a whole bunch of other stuff that also required volunteer hours.
For me, during ROTC, I was a non-traditional student, so I was older than most, so I had my enlisted duties that I was maintaining as well as cadet, so I didn't have much time for volunteering, but squadron type stuff I would volunteer for, then in ROTC, cadet type things where we would do recruiting events, I would volunteer where I could. Now I do volunteer with the Humane Society.
During high school, helped start a program at my high school that worked with getting the whole population of the school together as in a championship. We did a bunch of games and stuff. And then there wasn't much time between high school and college. Once I was in college, I did a volunteer opportunity with families and kids, just getting everybody out of the house, having a good time.
Because there's a lot of other factors that kind of play a part in that, like do you have a pilot's license and other different qualities that they're probably looking for if you're trying to go for a certain career field.
Like being in a non-rated and having a master's in that field is probably going to give you a one-up versus somebody who like just graduated out that field and I guess doesn't have experience. It just really depends on that. But I know when I went to my recruiter, they said my rated board had about a 33% acceptance rate, and the non-rated board had like 23, so obviously I went rated so I can get accepted, you know, better chance.
Does knowing four languages help? I assume this question is for someone who wants to be a linguist.
Yeah. Maybe like, I guess intel or linguist, maybe, but what we were discussing with this question was kind of understanding the difference between being an officer and enlisted, what jobs come with that. I think Nia, you explained it better the best way.
Basically, the quick, low down and dirty When you're enlisted, you're more like the worker bee, especially the lower tier, the younger airmen. So you're pretty much doing all the hands-on things. And then as you climb the rank ladder as an NCO, a senior NCO, you kind of move to a supervisory role and like managing people. Whereas as an officer, you're pretty much a manager, and you're dealing with like, you know, contracts and you know, you're not as hands-on. Some officers like to be a little, just to kind of show their face and let their people know, like, hey, I'm a person too and not a robot. But you pretty much won't be doing much hands-on work, more so managing.
Yeah, that about explains it. Unless you're rated, and then you get to do like awesome flying stuff. Yeah, so.
Slight plug.
Little plug. You can be like awesome like us or them, because I'm still trying to get there. Yeah, it really depends. The full person concept. So, they're gonna take a lot of things into account, like we were talking about earlier with the interview process. Yes, if you have like really strong parts of your work experience, like you were active in what you did was important, maybe you made yourself indispensable, that's great. But if you didn't have the opportunity to work, then volunteer experience is what they use. To show that you take initiative, you have gumption, you have ambition to go out and do stuff. I think that's about it. So yes, basically it depends.
Yeah, I mean, you definitely want to make your packet geared towards leadership and try to play that up as much as you can. But at the end of the day, they're going to understand what place in life you're applying from and kind of like probably what opportunities you have had thus far. So as long as you're taking advantage of all the opportunities and you're kind of playing up the leadership part, it's not like you can automatically rule yourself out for not having, you know, a lot of one or the other. But if you have the time, then yes, volunteer. And if you have the opportunity, yes, try to get in a leadership role. But, you know, don't get so hung up on the fact of having so much of one versus the other and where that's gonna kind of place you. I mean, think about it as you're applying to any kind of other job as well.
ROTC, it depends. not every school's detachment is run the same way. For me, we had PT 5 times a week. You weren't expected to go to all 5, but at least to go to 3 out of 5. But they also understood that everyone had different academic schedules, and some majors were more demanding than others. So if that was a case where you couldn't make it to PT, you were definitely expected to PT on your own and provide them with like a memo of all the workouts that you had done. So you had that as far as physical training. As far as academics, maintaining your normal course load on top of the military education courses that ROTC is required to give. So you're pretty busy every day.
Brilliant. generally for your freshman year, the physical aspect's pretty heavy. So make sure that you put in the work prior to you getting to the academy and preparing yourself for being able to pass. It's called a PFA at the academy, or excuse me, PFT. No. And you need to be able to do well on that. That way, if you do really well, you only have to take it once a year. But that's one big aspect of the physical spot. You'll go through basics, very physically demanding. And then once you get into the school year, if you are an intercollegiate athlete, so someone who was expected to play a sport while you were there, a lot of your free time outside of classes is going to be spent at practices if you aren't an intercollegiate athlete. And are considered someone who doesn't do that, then a lot of your time once or twice a week would be spent with the squadron doing physical stuff or mental stuff. But after your freshman year, it's on you to make sure that you're physically in shape, and the PFT is pretty demanding, so make sure that you keep that.
Well, honestly, in my experience, I felt like I was a little bit more physically prepared before I went to OTS, because because they have you doing so much that at some point you do PT with the squadron, but there are times where you really kind of had to PT by yourself to keep up to the physical capability, I guess, you had before you got there. So I know my runtime kind of suffered while I was there. I was still good enough to pass. But fortunately, they made you do push-ups, so I got, like, you know, major push-up points on my actual PFT. But overall, it's for OTS, the day-to-day training was like,
wake up. Structure.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was definitely structure. Mm-hmm. And,
four phases.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they wake you up at the crack of dawn, before the crack of dawn. and then you just have a lot to do all the time until you have lights out. Physically demanding, it was a lot. I feel like OTS is a lot more mentally challenging and emotionally challenging than physical. I know you kind of go through a lot in terms of task management and figuring out where you fit into military life. I mean, for me personally, like non-prior and being in a whole flight with prior ease, it was a big shift in my way of thinking.
What was like trying to teach you how to be a leader in like 8 weeks,
mm-hmm.
8 or 9.5 weeks. I can't remember how long the course is, somewhere around there. But the physical aspect of it, so when you first come in, they'll have you do like a baseline physical fitness test just to kind of gauge where you're at. And then halfway through the program, they'll do like a diagnostic. And then at the end, they'll have you take like your official PFT before you go off to, you know, your next training location for your actual career. And like we said, it was just, as far as academics, it was structured. We knew what we were doing every day. And there was things that you had to memorize and learn for each day, and they would just build on top of that up until the end.
Day-to-day training, in the beginning at OTS, you'll start out, you know, with the basics, learning, you know, marching and things of that sort, and then the academic aspect will pick up as you go. And your day is always going to start off with physical fitness, and then you're going to be doing some type of academics during the day, and also some team building, and also homework. And in terms of physical aspect, I mean, you could easily look up the requirements for your age, and do not go to OTS if you can't pass a physical fitness test, because they will say
yes,
home ASAP if you cannot pass. So
it is
make
really
sure you can do that.
It's real. It has happened.
It has happened, and it's really no excuse for you not to come prepared. Like, do well.
I think that's
yeah.
the case across the board.
Because
I know
yeah.
ROTC, you're expected to pass a PFA every semester, and if you don't,
And then from like we were in the same board. So from selection all the way until I went to OTS with like a couple classes before she did, and then we were in the same class, OTS class, and you have time from when you're selected to when you actually go to OTS to get your physical fitness up, and it's a process after you're selected, which if you have questions about that, you can, you know, write SJ and we can go into detail on that.
As my subscribers know, I had like a whole year and a half. So you have time.
I would say you should prepare before you get accepted.
Yeah.
To
mm-hmm.
get there. Like, it shouldn't be, oh no, I'm accepted now, let me get ready. It should be, all right, I want to do this, let me prepare. And then if you get accepted, you get accepted. If you don't, at least you have, like, you know, that physical, you know, hard body looking good thing going on. So, you know, play to win. Practice.
So UCC is a little different. They give you a little bit more leeway, but as the pipeline goes, you come here, you're a casual student, and you have to do PT 3 times a week. It is mandatory Monday, Wednesday with our PT instructor. She's a... She's a lot.
Yeah.
And she will get you whipped in shape. Basically, a lot of her workouts have to do with maintaining like G-forces and things in the aircraft. It's mostly Navy, so they all have jets and stuff. But anyway, after that, you're basically on your own for PT, and you also take a practice PFA every month while on casual. But after that, you're on your own for PT, and this is where people slip and slide. Don't slip and slide, because then you start gaining weight, and you take your PFA, and it's not pretty. So you just have to maintain your health and do what you have to do. But other than that, it's mostly just long days of academic studying and do what you have to do to get through the program. The program is a marathon. It is not a sprint. It's about a year long, and it's a lot to go through. Anybody else?
Yeah, just I guess piggyback off of that. If you want a little bit more detail on what it's like for UCT, so when you first class up, as they call it, you start your academics. You'll go with physio for a couple weeks, and then you'll actually jump or dive into your academics for like the fundamentals of flight per se. So you'll do that, and then this is all for T6, and then you'll jump into the flight line, and you'll actually get in the aircraft and start, instruments, and then you'll have advanced instruments, and you'll check for both of those, and then you'll go on to low levels. So the whole primary side was all with the T6, which is just basic flight fundamentals, and then you'll get into the T1 side, which is where you really get into the nitty gritty with what an EWO, which is an electronic warfare officer, a WISO, a weapon system officer, or a CISO, combat systems or combat sensor operator, and the different things that they can do. And then you'll go kind of like the T6, where you'll go to the flight line and you'll start implementing some of those things that you learned in advance on the flight line.
Yeah. Yep, and then you graduate and you get to be awesome aviators like these beautiful women right here. Brittany was a cadet. She got into a lot of community service programs. The college she went to had a service hour commitment. She went to, I believe, Jackson State. So during college, she was in National Honor Society's NAACP on campus, and as a lieutenant, she serves her community with community service and volunteering. Mostly as a casual, they also have you doing volunteering as well. But
I volunteered because
I'm proactive. But for day-to-day training, as she said, for ROTC for her school, it was a pretty normal college life student activities. The only extra thing she had to do on top of classes was do PT on Tuesday and Thursday mornings at 6, and leadership lab on Thursday afternoons. And then all this other, basically, PT on... Yeah, and she had to pass a PT test every semester. For officer school, she was saying, for her, she says typically classes are from 8 to 2. Afterwards, she usually works out and then studies. And when you start simulations, she usually starts about 5:30 and goes till 4.
That's your job.
Hmm?
Wait, what?
I'm confused. What?
What is she doing? What is this?
This is Brittany. She's in the program.
5:30? Was she in
ER?
She was specific to that. I was like, 5:30.
I know. She's like, I mean, she was answering the question. So 5:30 to 4, and afterwards, she usually works out in admission plans and studies. And on flight line, it depends on what time your actual flight is.
That's for a specific phase during the training. Every day is not like that. I know that's going to be real, daunting for some people who haven't spent, like, almost 12 hours even doing anything. But that is a certain phase of the training. Every day is not like that.
You're right, but I mean, to be fair, this is the furthest she's gotten in training so far. She just got into advanced. I think she starts T1 not too long from now, flight line.
Advanced is a T1 phase.
Mm-hmm.
If they have any questions about rated stuff or the UCISO pipeline or UCT, then definitely... hit us up, because we went through it or we're going through it. And
we'll leave our contact info down in the description. So
anybody have questions about the prior, Air National Guard, you know what I'm saying? I've done a little bit of everything. I'm a Renaissance woman.
Outside of schooling time, because everyone else had to like work jobs and stuff. So if you want to know like what you can do going straight from high school into like a military environment, but no, because everyone else is lip line.
Yeah, I mean, like, most people know I had like a year. I had a year in between, so I got to be a little bit of an adult.
But being an adult is not all it's cracked up.
They really
lie to you. They lie so hard.
Unless you go overseas.
But overall, it's fun. You meet great people. You get brand new experiences. And if this is a choice that you really want to make, first of all, make sure it's a choice you do want to make. And second of all, just stay committed if you're really about it.
I don't want to say, like, I understand that you're going into the military.
But do understand this. It doesn't get easier, you just get better.
Yeah.
I learned that. That's basic training.
Yeah.
Right?
That's what I learned. You get better. But I was close to too.
There you go.
I didn't like you, but it's true.
But on a real.
Alright. Someone, if you want to talk about your locks, someone did ask a question.
About, like, how do I have these?
She's a thug.
You know, if there's somebody out there that has locks and you're worried about cutting them off before you go, keep them really neat and make sure your bun is within the requirements. You know, check the regs, look at the pictures, and, you know, make it look like you got braids.
Make it till you make it.
You know, but you know, on a real, be prepared to have to cut those, you know, them off if something happens. But at the end of the day, I went into it ready and it never came back to me. I made sure I was in regs and it looked nice and neat. There are a lot of video tutorials on how to put your bun in different ways. I messed up doing those tutorials and figured out a way that worked for me. So, you know, there's hope out there. They don't work for you either. So, you know, just try it and see what happens. But at the end of the day, be prepared for it not to work. And at least either way, you'll, you know, be happy with the outcome.
I'm going to drop the link for the AFI for dress and appearances. And 36-2903. You're going to become well acquainted with that if this is a path for you. But thank you for joining us, and I hope this helps.
Good night.
Good night.
I hope you like my Donatella flag.
That's my